Welcome. I am your host, Billie Rae Bates. We are at AwesomeCon once again. We're having a great weekend so far. It's exciting. You're going to see a lot of action behind us on that convention floor as we're talking in today's episode. So what are we going to talk about? Well, this time we're going to talk about what does fandom mean to you and us and everybody, all of us geeky fans out here. And let me take a moment to introduce our panel that we've assembled to tackle this topic. We have Mike Dougherty.
Hi.
We have Maurice James.
Hello, people.
And we have Zach Winland.
Hi, everybody. I was going to do flips, but in the pre-tape, I hurt my knees, so this is the best you can have.
It was a you got to watch out.
You got the first thing.
Yeah, it was the whole thing.
Fandom, we can do a lot with that topic. Let's see where it goes. Let's start out, though, by talking about what are we fans of? What have we loved since we were kids? What do we love now? What do you love, Zach?
Since I was a kid, it's Star Wars. That's one of the first things that, you know, my parents put in front of me. And my parents weren't big geeks. And I grew up in a small town in West Virginia where I got my comics from the IG, the grocery store. So it was hard to keep up on stories, and you kind of picked them up as you were doing grocery shopping. I'm a Star Wars fan. That's the one thing that I remember as a kid, wearing out those VHSs. My mom had to join one of those monthly mail-away video things to get me new VHS copies of Star Wars, because I wore them out.
Yeah.
So that's the first thing. That's always going to have its place in my heart, because that's what I remember getting into.
Cool. Maurice?
For me, like, actually started off with comic books, because like I was always draw as a kid, so art. So I've always wanted to draw. They say, hey, you like drawing? Look at these books and like start from there. And also Star Wars.
Yeah.
Crazy huge fan, man.
Well, that's what everyone needs to get started.
Just like me, my parents bought me into it, because like I was a kid when Star Wars, Return of the Jedi came out, I was 1 year old.
Yeah.
So, hey, if your parents bring you to it, then that day you expand off of that. Man. So, you know, it's awesome, man.
So for me, it's absolutely Star Wars.
Okay.
I was born in 76, so I got to see stuff in the theater. Absolutely
I'm so jealous
comics. Like,
yeah.
I tore apart pages just to try to trace them and draw them before I understood that they could actually be valuable. But for me, the longest stay is Doctor Who. I was 3 years old. There's photos of me watching Doctor Who laying on my dog as Tom Baker's on the screen. And I love David Tennant. I love the new Doctors. But Tom Baker's my Doctor of all time.
That is so cool. For me, it's always been Batman, definitely, but really Batgirl first, because when I was a little girl, there were three different heroes in the comic books that my grandparents bought me, three different heroes that were female. There was Wonder Woman, Supergirl, and Batgirl.
Yep.
And Wonder Woman was the brunette, and I got to watch her on TV. I love the Linda Carter TV show so much. Supergirl was a blonde. I saw her in comics, too. But Batgirl was the redhead. So I thought, oh, my gosh, I could grow up to be Batgirl, maybe. I guess that's part of what fandom means to me, too, is dreaming when you're a kid of growing up to be that thing.
I like to think fandom is more along the lines of it's something you love more than your family. Like, and that's a weird way to look
more
at it.
More than your family.
But
it's true.
You're not talking more than your kids, though, right?
Well, no, sometimes.
As someone
sometimes.
Well, I was going to leave that alone as someone without kids. So, but no, it's one of those things where this is something you feel passionate about.
Yeah.
So
that's the key word right there.
Yeah, and that's why on the internet, why people get so upset is because we're such like huge fans of it.
Yeah.
That when somebody messes with our stuff. We take it personal.
It's like you're breaking my toy.
Yeah, exactly. You're messing with my childhood, like messing with that, yeah.
And I think it's not just your toy, it's our toy. And that's what fandom is. Like, you're a fan of something. But fandom is the community aspect of all of it. When four of us are sitting here and we're all Star Wars fans, it's a small fandom of people.
Right.
Yeah. And we're collectively, we may have our small differences of who our favorite character is, but that community as a whole is what wraps around that particular fandom.
So it's a sense of community is important.
Absolutely.
Because when you love something, you want to share the love. You want to talk about it with people. You want to meet other fans. You want to swap ideas. You want to argue things. You want to debate.
Well, that is the joy of fandom. Is like, as someone who, I came to comics later. So I'm a huge fan of comics now. I read a lot of comics. But beforehand, I didn't have that. And once I went to a store and started experiencing that idea of being able to yell and scream about the fact they killed off Batman, or yell and scream about the fact that the Joker has a new costume, or Harley Quinn's been changed, that was important, that ability to go ahead and get that expression out. And the community is a part of it too, because even if you don't find like-minded people, it's nice to know you have people that you can talk to about.
Absolutely.
And be able to share.
Yeah, I met one of my best friends because we like the same movie. Like he was a friend of my friend, and like we made the same movie, and we talked about it for about an hour, and we became like good friends of that, like one of some of the best friends, because we started off as fans of one particular thing.
Yes, well, I have that experience with Dukes of Hazzard too. Yeah. I love Dukes of Hazzard.
My grows from
closest
there, yeah.
friends in my life right now, they're either from working at the Detroit News or from the Dukes of Hazzard, just the fan community.
I'm in the same way. I mean, I grew up, like, I'm a big guy now, but I grew up a small, skinny kid.
Yeah.
And it was really hard to meet people because I wasn't always socially out there. Yeah. But when I found the first kid that had like a Batman comic, I was like, we're talking.
Yeah. There you
like,
go.
And you just find that one person that you can connect
Common
with.
Common ground.
It's like breaking the ice, man.
And I wonder, too, how much the word fan is synonymous with the word geek, too. Or is geek like an extreme form of fandom?
Well, I think what's really going on with the terminology is that geek has always had a... I'm trying to think of the right word. A haze over it. This negative connotation.
Yeah, or nerd. Nerd is even worse.
Because fan is just is just short for fanatic. Yeah. Anyone who's a sports fan or anyone who watches anything who's fanatical about something is a fan.
Mm-hmm.
And so there isn't I don't think there is the stigma with the word fan. I think the stigma comes from the subculture of Star Wars, comics, movies. I think there are certain fandoms that are more accepted, like being a sports fan, being a DC sports fan or a Baltimore sports fan or a Pittsburgh sports fan, when really it comes down to more, we're all in the same boat and we're all we enjoy things just as much as each other, and it's finding the common ground that needs to kind of be able to guide that, and I think that's happening more.
Well, I'm actually like happy to live in the age that we live in, is because 10 years ago, I could not talk to somebody that was a hardcore sports fan and get them to understand that what they're fans about is just as equal to my fandom for Star Wars.
Exactly. Like,
full circle as far as like, you know, where it was now and where you know where it was then.
Yeah, because the same way that, you know, my friend's a fan of Ray Lewis and can tell me the stats of Ray Lewis and who he played with and how many tackles.
And that's fanatical.
That's fanatical.
That is getting geeky.
Exactly.
That is
geeky.
And that's when I'm on the other side talking all about the different Robins between Tim Drake to Jason Todd, like all of those things, and then we could actually figure out there's an actual common ground between two separate fandoms where we could actually start bringing each other together.
Yeah.
Well, okay. I wonder if maybe that's because of the rise of fantasy sports, if that's kind of allowed the geek side of sports to come out, because
you be more stats now.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. You kind of get to, instead of being the guy that throws on every Sunday your jersey, you're the guy that's trying to find out who's going to be the quarterback that's going to score the most points, or who's going to be the best third baseman for your lineup week in fantasy. Like, I wonder if the rise of that has caused more of an acceptance of just fandom as a whole, and more from the sports side to go, okay, you guys can talk about old Robins. It's just as ridiculous as me arguing who's the best outfielder. Should I pick Adam Jones or should I take Josh Harrison?
Like, absolutely. Yeah. And to me, nowadays, I think people are understanding there's no difference between the Ravens fan that gets black and purple makeup and puts on a jersey and goes and tailgates to the guy that's out on this floor dressed as Batman.
Right.
They take the same amount of time, the same amount of effort, the same amount of care. They just care about that portrayal of their fandom so much.
But I also think that the geeks are now the CEOs, so the geeks are running the world now. So it's probably because like they run everything now. So geeks
have inherited the earth.
Yeah, they exactly. To put like a better term, you're right.
I love that. The geek has inherited the earth.
That is true.
So we can find sometimes that we have interesting ways of expressing our fandom. And Mike, I think you've got an interesting way because you love Firefly and you actually made a movie out of it.
Yeah, I have the dubious honor of creating a movie called Browncoat's Redemption. I got 20th Century Fox's approval and Joss Whedon's blessing.
Wow.
And made a feature-length fan film. It had Adam Baldwin makes a cameo, Michael Fairman, who played Niska, the guys that did Fanti and Mingo, and then people involved in the fandom, like PJ Harzma, the sci-fi writer, who co-founded Kids Need to Read with Nathan Fillion. We had Sonny Rhodes, who sang the theme song from Firefly, actually make an appearance.
Amazing.
And for me, that movie was bred because I love Firefly. Like, I watched it on TV. I remember seeing Train Job, the first episode, and trying to chase that show down as Fox jumped it around to different spots and put Major League Baseball in between it.
And were there things, though, about the characters and about the show that you wanted to add your own influence? Like, were there things that you felt creatively you kind of changed in the essence of the character of the
show?
Well,
I didn't want to touch the sacred cows.
Or did you remain 100% true?
To me, Firefly on TV was what Star Wars was when I was a kid.
Ah.
It's big space western. It's spaceships. It's like I always related to Han Solo more than anything else.
Yeah.
And Malcolm Reynolds is the modern-day Han Solo.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when I wanted to create a movie, I wanted to do what they did with Star Trek The Next Generation. I wanted to keep it in the same world, but I wanted a separate crew with new adventures.
Mm-hmm.
So there's the movie Serenity, and I just fast-forwarded the timeline 3 months.
Okay, but with the same characters.
New characters.
New
all
characters.
New characters,
okay.
New same world. So,
so
there's
your
a lot
own
of familiar for fans.
Sort of spin on it.
Exactly,
yeah.
Because you don't want to be that guy that's like, oh, I tried to cast Nathan Fillion, but I got this other guy. Nathan Fillion is Malcolm Reynolds, hands down. But, yeah, I mean, the movie was made by fans. The cast and crew were fans.
That
we had extras
so
cool. And crew from all over the world come to help out. It got distributed around the world from my living room. So people would come in, like, groups of 20, just pack up DVDs, and we'd ship them out. And it was made by the fans.
Wow. I mean,
that sounds a lot like kind of the punk rock movement, especially
absolutely.
Here in the D.C. area, where you had that PMA movement, that do it, do everything yourself, put everything together, get it out there. Now, I wondered, like, is there going to be more of this? Are they is Fox going to allow you to do more of these? Like these.
Well, I mean, honestly, the fans have spoken. I mean, we've shipped 6,000 copies around the world. We had tons of convention appearances. So as long as the community wants it and we can rally them behind it, I think Fox could get behind it. But until there's... Yeah, I don't want to say yes, absolutely, because
yeah,
I don't want to put them in an uncomfortable situation.
Well, but, you know, I could. I'll work for them. So I know, yeah. Like, tell them to set it free. Tell them set it free.
It's a cool
thing.
Yeah,
Fox is going to make a lot of money with X-Men, Apocalypse, and Fantastic Four. They should just go ahead and do it. It's fine. Just let it be.
They got the cash, man. Like,
yeah. What's nice is that Firefly's been off the air for 10 years.
And the fan base is still.
And they're still creating products, and they're still creating tons of stuff.
Yeah, wow. Okay, so that's going to bring us to the end of this segment.
Great.
Glad that you're around. And we are going to come back, but first we're going to show you something cool.
Peace.
Yeah.
Yes.
Ulysses Campbell for Fantastic Forum. We're here at AwesomeCon DC, and I have the pleasure of being with Miss Elizabeth Henstridge. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. You got a great voice.
Well, thank you.
Just turn it right on.
Well, I'm a professional, as are you, and you know all the fans love your performance as Jenna Simmons on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Thank you very much. I love playing her. It's the best job ever.
Well, I can imagine. I already said, anybody ever cast me on a series, I'm never getting off of that thing, you know?
Yeah, I know. You're just going to stick as long as you can.
So what's it like doing the show?
It's awesome. I mean, we're one big happy family, and, you know, it's like going to work with your best friends, and we get to do what we love to do, which is act as is, you know, the aim of the career. So, yeah, as long as we're acting, we're usually happy. So it's a great time.
Had you been a fan of the comic book series prior to being cast?
I hadn't read the comics, but I'd seen all the movies. So that's how I was introduced to the Marvel Universe, and then I've read comics since being in the show. But I love sci-fi. I love the kind of social questions you can pose. And I just feel like our show has good morals at its center. So it's always nice to be involved in something that I want to portray that to younger people, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the interesting things about your character, you started out, you're a total science geek, and now they've sort of, you know, you're getting on more missions, you're doing more of the espionage-y thing. What's that like, and will we see more of that?
I hope we see more of it. It's really fun. I mean, I love all sides of her character, so as she starts to become a bit more accomplished, then yeah, I guess we'll definitely see some more of that, but I haven't seen anything of season 4 yet, so I can't tell you.
And how are you enjoying the convention so far?
Yeah, I'm loving it. I've had such a great weekend. It's been really great.
The fans really love being able to see you.
Yeah, I enjoy it too. Everyone's been super nice. It's been a really good weekend.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. We hope we see you again at next year's AwesomeCon.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Wonderful. Ulysses Campbell for Fantastic Forum here at AwesomeCon. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Fantastic Forum. We are having a great time discussing what fandom means to us and to you. But you know what? I think sometimes fandom goes too far, right?
Absolutely.
Does fandom go too far sometimes?
Absolutely.
What examples can you think of? Like either online or in person?
Online's the best example. And the biggest thing of fandom going too far is Reddit.
Oh, Reddit's terrible.
Yeah. Reddit, like, I
love Reddit, but...
I am a Redditor, and it's changed the way I get news and all that sort of stuff. But Reddit has communities that are toxic to be a part of, where you can go in there and try and want to start an actual conversation or be able to go ahead and debate whether or not Heath Ledger was better than Jack Nicholson or Cesar Romero and all that. And what happens is you get these... They're trolls, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's what they call them.
And all their goal is just to get you angry and to go ahead and get you to yell at them.
Instigators.
Yeah, just
why do people do that? Why are people online just to start stuff?
It's strictly like, there's no way that you could retaliate from me in a way that's actually going to hurt me.
There's no repercussions, right? It's not face-to-face communication.
You can't hurt me with words, so I'm just going to poke the bear as many times. Like, I had that experience on Broncos when we were promoting it. Somebody put up an interview, and the interview was completely wrong. So I spent 8 hours online battling trolls as the guy who made the movie and fighting with people arguing with me what's right and what's wrong. But you had a story about New York Comic Con, didn't you?
Well, this has more to do with kind of any con you go to nowadays. Like, you see the signs that say cosplay is not consent, or are you feeling harassed, kind of breaking that up. And in New York, I was blessed to go this last year. I was all there all 4 days. On Saturday, because of the amount of media guests that's there, the con used to be a safe place where it's guys like us, we could sit around and talk about Star Wars, and it's not anymore. It's becoming a little more overtaken by people that are maybe here just to get stuff signed by Jason David Frank or an MMA fighter that's there. Or
so somebody harassed a young lady or like what?
Oh, well, what was going, it wasn't my lady. I was outside, and when I was outside, I saw this woman who was in this classic Scarlet Witch outfit.
Yeah.
It's great. It's one of the awesome costumes. And I think her boyfriend was Quicksilver, which made it a little awkward.
Big brother and sister.
If it was Ultimates, it would have been funnier.
Yeah.
But so they're outside, and this dude comes up to her, and he is like wearing a tap out shirt, hat back, and like tribal tattoos.
Right.
Takes his hand and smacks her on her chest. Leaves an imprint, like just because he feels like he could. The boyfriend, being the boyfriend, rears back and knocks him out. Because, again, what's your reaction going to be when someone does that to your girl? And the thing, I never thought I'd ever see that in my life at a con. I will give the staff for New York Comic Con credit because they got everything right. They went to pull the boyfriend out, and the boyfriend said, no, he smacked my girl on the chest. And they went, really? And he said, look at her chest. It's a big red handprint. And they went, okay. And so they picked the dude up before he woke up. And just kind of drug him out by the scruff of his neck.
That's the thing about fandom going so far, but now everybody's involved in it, so you're getting so many people like that. So people who are not normally just like being cool about it, like you might get the uncool cats who don't like know how to just know how to be cool about it, or just appreciate it.
Appreciate it for the fact that
they'll be a creep and like try to touch somebody.
Yeah, like they appreciate it.
Don't be a creep.
Seriously.
There's no fun.
If anything, don't be a creep.
Because if you be a creep, then all the costumes that we love that we want to see, we'll never see them again.
Yeah.
They'll all be hung up and they'll all be somewhere else.
Creeps ruin everything.
They are the bane of the existence.
I mean, and let's not lie, we're at a Comic Con, there's a lot of extremely attractive women with very revealing clothes that took a lot of time to put those costumes together. They're more than willing to take a photo with you. That's no room to be an ass.
It's not. Like, you should always, at the very point in time, respect the person in the costume.
Right, absolutely.
Because at the end of the day, not just do they put a lot of work in to get to that costume, they put a lot of work into themselves to get themselves to be at that point where they're confident enough and they're physically sound enough to be able to walk in and be that character, be that person for that day. And that takes more guts than anything that you can think of doing. That's to me the equivalent of releasing a film, writing a song, putting it out there for the world to see.
Yeah. Because if you want to do all that, go to the strip club. It costs just as much as going to the Comic Con.
Exactly. Your $80 will get you far.
Get a table dance or something.
Yeah, exactly. And the other side of the coin is you don't know if this cosplayer, this is her first cosplay, and she's extremely nervous, or her 100th. Yeah. Either way, the behavior is inexcusable, but you could potentially be ruining all the hard work one person put in just for a really bad moment.
Yeah, because that's an expression of fandom, too, is the whole cosplay thing.
Yeah.
You know, people love it. It's like dreaming of being that character. It's like a form of an escapism, and it shouldn't be a negative experience.
No,
it's not just the thing of escaping. It's the biggest form of flattery. It's the biggest thing of going, this is someone who... I have identified with for as long as I've been in the fandom, I now want to go ahead and be that person. And as someone that's, I'm a wrestling fan, so I've done some light cosplay as a wrestler, which is very easy to do, but there's kind of this real sense that as you're going through and you're doing this where you have the fans that are, they're going, I want to get a picture with you. There's a cool thing to be like, I put the effort in this and they're responding to it. So it's really awesome.
Yeah, and I think if we look back at fandom online too, not just fandom in person, but fandom online, you know, one of the ways that a lot of people express their fandom is by extreme criticism, also hating. You know, we talked about trolls, and they just want to incite things. I mean, what is that all about? Why is it human nature? And like we talked about before, there's like no repercussions. It's not face-to-face. You can't see the person's expression.
It's honestly no repercussions. I mean, like, I'm going to say anything to you I can because I'm covered behind a keyboard and miles of internet cable.
Right.
So why does it matter what you think if I'm just going to tell you you're wrong? And the other side of the coin is you have a lot of people who this may be their only way to socially interact. They don't feel comfortable going to events like this.
Exactly.
They can't feel comfortable having conversations. You literally gave a voice.
Yeah.
That's the best way of saying it.
Yeah.
And now they're like, well, this is my avenue. And what's amazing today is Twitter's starting to stop that. There's a guy that's been banned. He's created an account within minutes. It's off. Reddit's starting to get a little bit more stronger.
Yeah, and Facebook has been pretty good at looking at stuff like that, what people post and if people file it as offensive. You know, they've been pretty good
also
at clamping down
like
on that.
You gotta give certain things a chance, though. Like, cause even like when somebody like casts a certain character, so like for instance, like people, Ben Affleck is Batman.
I didn't have a problem with it.
I have no problem with it. I think he's pretty good. Like, but some people like are railing on it because they can't get past Ben Affleck as Daredevil, or because he was in a couple bad movies, Reindeer Games.
It's judgment. Daily. You know, it's judging, and there's kind of a fine line.
Affleck was the bomb in Phantoms. That's the one thing we have to realize.
Affleck was
the
bomb
in Phantoms. We're going to be okay with that.
But what fans need to realize is this man is the only man to play Batman, Daredevil, and Superman. Because Ben Affleck played George Reeves in the movie about George Reeves' death.
Yes, that was a good movie.
Only
I like
man,
that
like,
movie.
Why are you hate? This guy is like living the nerd dream.
In Kevin Smith movies.
And Kevin Smith
as a comic book artist.
Right.
Yeah. So, give the man a chance.
He is a comic fan.
Like, yeah, he's a super
he
fan.
He wrote the intro to Kevin's Daredevil volume, the Vision of the Guardian Devil.
Guardian Devil.
And he's talked about before about the reason he took the Daredevil movie wasn't just for the paycheck, which was why he did Paycheck, but he did it to go ahead and because this was his chance to be his idol.
I didn't hate that movie. I didn't hate
right
it.
Right here.
Right? Yeah. Let me go. True abysmal. I didn't
hate
it.
I was the only one. No. Thank
but
God.
When, when he, like, his vision, like, hair and things, how they showed it, that was pretty cool.
The director's cut for me was the addition.
Yeah. Yes.
The theatrical one was a little bit crap. It was a little bit too much romantical stuff. But the director's cut, if you have not seen Daredevil yet, watch the director's cut of Daredevil.
Yeah.
Well, because the one scene, and spoiler if you haven't seen the movie, the one scene that changed it for me, that changed the whole tone of the movie, is that moment on the balcony when he's there with Elektra.
Oh, yeah.
And in the PG-13 version, you have them going ahead and doing the, where he goes and he stays there with Elektra. In the R-rated version, he goes off to crack heads. That's Daredevil. Like, that one change made me go,
that's why
what's
supposed
to happen.
So good, because in the Netflix show, he's cracking skulls.
That's all he's worried about, is saving the
all
city.
All 13 episodes, he's cracking skulls.
Oh, I love it.
Okay, so getting back to the hate online, I think sometimes what I have found in the different fan communities that I have been a part of is that there's a sense of ownership. There's kind of a weird, little bit twisted sense of ownership. Do you remember back in the late 90s when all of these fan websites started popping up for TV shows and movies? Yeah. People started building websites for something that they loved. That was an expression of fandom too. If I created a website on Dallas and put, you know, like photos and information on there, and then somebody else wanted to create a website on the same thing, it's like they're like, why does she have a website? You know, it's almost like a competition thing when there's more than enough fandom and love to go around, but people have like a sense of ownership and they want to be like the number one fan. You know, I think sometimes.
I honestly feel like that's kind of gone away with the immediacy of the internet now.
Yeah.
I feel like at first there was wanting to have this ownership of being a fan is because you want to be the one that is, you want to wear it on your shoulder, your badge of honor. That's what you want to be. But now it's a little easier because there's no way to be first now.
Yeah.
Someone is always ahead of you. Someone is always trying to outdo you.
Yeah.
Now the sense of community can kind of be a bigger part of it.
The best example I'll say is like if George Lucas can give up Star Wars, and he created it, You don't own it. You didn't create Star Wars, so you can't.
Right.
You can't,
it's he's for all of us to share.
That personal gripe. Yeah.
I think it also has to do with, like you just mentioned, today's society. It's like the internet has democratized every fandom. 10 years ago, fanzines like were the only way to get things. 20 years ago, you had to find a comic book or a newspaper or go to a shop like this to be able to think. Like now, it's across the board. So back then, yeah, you were really important because you created the first thing in Baltimore. Mm. But now it's like, yeah, you did Baltimore, but then there's Philly and everybody else. Instead of just trying to separate it, bring everything together.
Well, and also, it was a little more of a lonely experience too back then because
I'm a little Boondock Saints too.
It's our pet, our special mascot.
I knew I should have left him in the car.
Yeah. But at least from that guy.
Exactly. But no, I found like as a kid, like I was mentioning before, it was hard to find books. Like I got them at the IGA, so it wasn't easy for me to get into fandom. And if I would have had to make the conscious effort to be there every Wednesday or whenever the books were released. Now it's a little easier to go ahead and get into the fandom and be a part of it. So you still have the connection to it in this connection community, but you don't have this whole, I'm putting this all over my back. Like, yeah. I am the flag bearer for this in my area.
Yeah. And you mentioned before we started that you're a fan of Dukes of Hazzard, mm-hmm. and that show's been around since the 80s. So like, fans getting together about Dukes of Hazzard was so much harder then.
It was before the internet. There were events that people went to, but it was harder then because we weren't as connected. The internet has changed everything.
Had a General Lee car that we sat together in the 80s. Yeah.
Well, sad to say, that is about the time that we have for today. It's been a great discussion. We've had a lot of fun with it. And we are having a great, awesome con. This is an event that you have to check out if you have never done so. It's a big event. It's now in its third year, and we are loving it. So thank you for tuning in. Share your thoughts with us. Email us, like us on Facebook, send us a message. Check us out at fantasticforum.tv. And most of all, tune in next time.
All right. Be awesome, y'all.
Thank you, Ben Penrod, for awesome con.
Have a great day.
Join the Fantastic Forum fan community on Facebook and follow us on Twitter for all the latest news and updates.